Hello and welcome to Travel Line. Today we have with us a celebrity chef called Ritu Dalmia, who actually needs no introduction. She's a very well-renowned name when it comes to Italian food and owns the Diva restaurant in New Delhi that has been winning people's hearts for over two decades now. She also runs two very successful restaurants in Milan called Sitemani and Speak Up. She's also the author of a few books, and today she is here with us to tell us all about Italian cuisine. Thank you for joining us, Ms. Dalmia.
Thank you, Pallavi.
Ms. Dalmia, can you just begin by telling us, like, when did you realize your love for Italian cuisine?
Very early in life, I have to admit. I come from a vegetarian family. So in the early days, the only cuisine, international cuisine, which had vegetarian options was Italian. So I think my love for Italian food really started when I was very young. And honestly, it's not a tough cuisine to love. It's a food which is universally loved by everyone. It's there's a reason why it's the number one cuisine in the world. It's really, as I said, there's something very wholesome and comforting about the cuisine. So yes, as I said, I was very, very young, maybe 10, 11, when I really found my love for Italian food.
So is this one of the reasons why you feel, like you said, Italian food has something so comforting about it? Is that one of the reasons why it's become so popular across the world and in India as well?
Yes, I think that would be the good reason. In India, again, because as I said, we like flavors. You know, we don't like bland food. And Italian food is bursting with flavors. It's honest. There's something very honest about the food. And as I said, it's flavorful. It's about taste and not just about how it looks. So yes, I think that's the reason it's popular. It's number one cuisine in the world. And as I said, also for vegetarians, which many of us are in India, it's really got the highest choices in terms of vegetarian cooking than any other European cooking.
And then what encouraged you to open Diva restaurant?
You know, before Diva, there was another Italian restaurant I used to run in early 90s. But for me, honestly, Diva really is the beginning of my food journey. And when I came back from UK, I moved back to India in 1999. And India had really changed by then. People were traveling a lot more. There was a lot more disposable income. Younger people were spending a lot more. So I think for me, it was a perfect timing. And yes, it was a perfect timing when I opened Diva 21 years ago. And Delhi was more than ready for it. India was more than ready for it. And at the end, as I said, it was about honest cooking. And that's what Diva provided and still does.
But what are your future plans for Diva? Like, do you plan to open in other cities as well?
You know, honestly, this is not really the best time to plan many things. It's been already a harrowing, tough 2 years for everyone in the food industry, especially in the food industry. So Diva, like I said, we just opened a restaurant in Bombay a week ago, which is at the Good Earth Raghuvanshi Mills store, and not under the name of Diva, but managed by Diva. And honestly, I would say, apart from what we're doing a little bit in Bombay, I'm not in a position to really plan anything long term, because we don't know what tomorrow holds. So at the moment, it's about really consolidating. It's about making sure that the business gets solid again. So if there is yet another anything like COVID, you can survive it.
Absolutely. We all need the courage to survive. Like, if yes, there's even another third wave, but fingers crossed, there shouldn't be.
Absolutely.
So tell me, like, is there, you've seen like Diva go through these two decades. Has the flavor profile of the Indian audience changed over the years?
I think it has quite a lot. You know, it's not about the flavor profile per se. At the end of the day, I'm like any other good Indian who, after 3-4 days of eating international food, I want my curry chawal or dal chawal. But the thing is, what's happened, as I told you, is traveling became so much more. Exposure of palate became so much more. So people don't want a bastardized Italian anymore. People don't want food that is, let's say, Indianized anymore. So they are exposed enough to want the gnocchi the same way. Also what's changed is they are more aware of regional food per se than the so-called generic Italian food. So yes, I think you can't mess around with the guest anymore. You can't mess around with the clients anymore, because I think they know what they're talking about and they know what they're like. And you better give it to them the right way, in the honest way, authentic way, because they know that when you're messing around with that part.
Absolutely. I think people have really evolved, like you said.
Absolutely.
What do you think is the future of Italian cuisine in India? Like, do you,
you know, sweetheart, I'm really not the best person to, how shall I say, make trend comments or say what's the future. I live each day the way it is. And I think in general, eating out is there to stay, because when you're depressed, you want to eat out. When you're happy, you want to celebrate, you want to eat out. So it's not only a future of Italian food. I hope all cuisines have a fabulous future, but I'm really not the best person to talk about any trends per se. I wish I knew, but I don't.
No, I understand that completely. So tell us something about your favorite Italian dishes. What do you like eating the most?
I like lots of it. Depends also what I'm eating for. Am I eating alone? Am I eating with someone? But the classic simple spaghetti with pomodoro sauce, which is just tomato, basil and extra virgin olive oil, is always something which is my comfort food, which is my dal chawal of Italian food. I love it. I love gnocchi. A well-made gnocchi, potato gnocchi, which just melts in your mouth, is always fabulous. And also, there are a lot of amazing street food in Italy, which is something I really love too. So it really depends on the month or the how shall I say, time frame or the state of mind that I am. But spaghetti pomodoro never misses a beat with me.
Absolutely, it sounds absolutely fabulous. Can you tell us a little bit about Italian street food? Because not many people know about that right now.
Sorry?
Can you tell us a little bit about Italian street food?
Lots of it. So, you know, in a way, Italian street food is also a bit like Indian street food. Every region has its own speciality, and you'll be surprised that even the Italians sometimes are not aware of it. But it's the same with Indian food. I mean, if I was to talk about something from Chettinad, I may know it's Chettinad food in general, but I don't know the intricacies because I'm up here in North. And if you go to someone in South and you talk to them about the Shakar Gandhi or Aloo Tikki Chaat from the North, or Bedmi Aloo from UP, they wouldn't know about it, okay? Or they may. So it's the same in some ways with Italian street food. Every region has its own speciality. When you go to Tuscany, you have panigacci. You go to Umbria, you have something like torta di testa. You go to other parts of Tuscany, there's testaroli. So as I said, there are so many different things that even it's really very regional food per se. You know, the gnocco fritto, which is really like a bhatura, Italian bhatura, or a pizza fritta, which is a leftover pizza which is fried from Naples, an amazing street food. So I think the only way to discover it is to actually do a little trip all around the villages of Italy, and you will get to know it all.
Absolutely. So you said you have a love affair with Italy. So can you tell us some interesting travel experiences over there?
Oh, way too many. We need a whole day to discuss that, Pallavi. But again, as I said, every area, every zone has something new to give. So, I mean, it's really, you have to go with an open mind. The first part you need to do is what you have, the golden triangle in India, which is Delhi, Agra, Jaipur. The same in Italy is Florence, Venice and Rome. But that's only the beginners. And then again, you need to experience it state-wise. You need to experience it regional-wise. So for me, as I said, Liguria was all about discovering suddenly how fish can be so amazing. Our Tuscany was about bread without salt, because they refused to pay the taxes on salt to Venice in the ancient days. So I learned many things through the food via its history in some ways. And I think I've been traveling to Italy now for nearly 40 years, and there's still something new that I discover every time I go there. It's not something I can talk about. It's something you got to experience it yourself.
I think that's lovely, because I think most of the cities should be discovered by walking, especially in Italy.
Absolutely.
I think that's where the fun lies.
Super.
The coffee culture is very, very big in Italy. Can you tell us something about that? Like, do you yourself?
I love coffee. I drink a lot of coffee. And what's nice now is I have a small shop very near my house, which is basically does different coffees, different ways it's roasted. And they grind it in front of you as per your liking of how strong or how light you like it. And it's really like a small individual store. So what's nice about Italy and the coffees is it's not about just big brands. Everyone has a little coffee shop or a coffee vendor who they prefer, who they like, and you can argue for hours and hours whose coffee is better than the other one. Also, I mean, they always say that coffee is best from Naples. So the coffee is most famous from Naples, and everyone says it's not about the coffee beans there, it's about the water. So if you see a Cafe Napolitano, which is Napoli style cafe, you strongly must go and enter. And coffee is a way of life, just the way chai is our way of life. Coffee is a way of life, but also it also in some ways also represents the lifestyle of Italians, who are very easygoing, who are not in that over ambitious mood. So you go in the morning, you have your little espresso in the office, you come out for a cigarette, you have another espresso. So in a way, it's a very slow moving life, and coffee plays a very important role in that. So I think coffee culture in Italy is more a representation of how life should be without the, you know, this everyday fight of who's gonna do more, and just a slow pace, an easy pace, and about taking it easy.
That is so well put. Oh my God. I mean, that is really actually the way everyone should function.
Yes.
So tell us some of, like, what would be your three favorite ingredients or spices to cook with, like, when it comes to Italian food?
So Italian food, for me, the most important thing that I need is a very good olive oil, some basil, and some good tomatoes. After that, I can create magic of all forms if I have these three ingredients in my fridge or in my kitchen.
Lovely. So three Italian dishes that we love in India, but Italians would never eat. Can you tell us something about that?
So there's not really much of it, but let's say it depends how they eat it. So for example, we love pizzas. In Italy, pizza is more a meal, a lunch they have on Sundays. When they don't cook at home, they always order pizza or go out for pizzas. So Italians also love pizzas, but it is not only about pizzas, what their food is. And secondly, we all talk only about pastas. Again, pasta is only a first course. It's a small part of their meal, the carbohydrate before the protein comes. So an Italian would not eat, okay, let's order four pastas and four pizzas for the table and share it. For them, it would be either a pizza or a pasta, but not together, because they both are carbohydrates. And they, if they're doing a pasta, they may do a protein after that, or they may do a cold antipasti before that. So the way Italians eat is very different from Indians. It's not about that they don't love it, but as I said, how it is placed in their food or in their life is very, very different. That's the only big difference there.
Absolutely, that it is. There is a big difference. So what are some of the most interesting food experiences that a person visiting Italy should have when they're coming maybe for the first time?
So again, depends which part of Italy you are in. But as I said, make sure you visit the local food markets, which every city, every town has. That will give you a very, very good idea. And again, if you are in Rome, you've got to try the amatriciana or a carbonara. If you're in Milan, you need to have the cotoletta, or you need to have the risotto milanese. So again, talking about food experience, it has to be really region specific rather than, in general. So once they decide which part of Italy they are going to, they should try to stick to the local cuisine and what is famous in that cuisine rather than what they know, which is, let's say, pasta with cheese or pasta with tomato or a pizza. They should more focus on what are the regional specialities rather than the so-called international specialities.
Can you tell us something which people may not know about Italian cuisine? Make some interesting information, some trivia.
About?
Italian cuisine, something which people may not know.
There's so many of them. You'll be surprised about the similarities some of the Italian food has with Indian food. So this is my biggest joke, or what I laugh about, because a lot of Indian food has Arab influence. And the Arabs were also there in south part of Italy. So what they have as their famous dessert, marzipane, I always say it's nothing but our badam ki barfi. And then you go to a place called Sarzana, which is in Tuscany, and you eat this very famous dish called farinata di ceci, which is like a besan ka pura eaten with a piece of bread. Then you have something called panelle in Sicily, which is your gatia. So you will be surprised how many dishes are actually so similar to Indian food, which no one would believe. But at the end, when the crusaders and the, all the invaders went all around the world, they left a mark of their food everywhere they went.
How interesting. That's really interesting information that you're giving us. Now I'm going to ask you a tough one. Which is your favorite Italian restaurant in the country?
In Italy. In Italy?
Yeah.
Again, lots of them. Lots of them. So, in terms of respect, I have a lot of respect for a restaurant called La Calandre, which is in Padua near Venice. A very young Italian chef who I think really showcases Italian food beautifully. And I'm not saying this because she's my business partner, but Viviana Varese, who has a Michelin star restaurant in Milan. Again, for me, I'm so jealous of her because she's so super talented, and sometimes I wish I was like her. So if I was to say, these two are really my all-time favorite Italian restaurants in Italy.
So who do you think is the most interesting Italian chef who's made a name for himself or herself globally when it comes to Italian cuisine?
Massimo Bottura. I think the name that he has created internationally, globally, for Italian, what he has done, not only for the cuisine, but also for feeding the hungry, for giving dignity to ensuring that everyone is fed properly, and his various charity works. I think what he has done globally for Italian food, no one else has done so far. Yes.
That's true. Actually, he has created a very big difference for the cuisine and itself.
Yes.
So can you tell us some differences in the cultural traditions of different cuisines, different regions of Italy?
I'll tell you. If you go in upper north part, it is a lot more delicate, a lot more meat oriented, a lot butter oriented. As you travel south, you will find olive oil gets more and more important. Desserts up north is a lot more delicate. You go to Sicily, the desserts are overly sweet, more or less like Indian sweet. So that's where I say it's the Arab influence. The cooking of the pasta, when we talk about al dente or when it has to have a bite, it really differs from north to south. As you travel from north, it's slightly more cooked, whilst as you go more south, the rice and the pasta is a little bit less cooked. So it's really more, like I said, more al dente than it is in the north. tomatoes, the use of tomatoes, the style of vegetables, North Piedmont, etc. The food is richer.
So one last question, is there an easy way to make a home Italian recipe that you would recommend?
There's so many of them. As I said, a simple pasta sauce, a tomato basil sauce, where you just need to, you know, fry a whole piece of garlic with a piece of chili, red chili, add the tomatoes, let it simmer on slow fire, remove the chili, remove the garlic, because the garlic is just for aroma and the chili is just for the hint. Salt, basil, extra virgin olive oil, and you have the basic tomato sauce. You can add that in a pasta, you can use that over grilled meats or chicken. You can use that as a sauce for grilled eggplant and make a parmigiana. You can puree it, you know, and make a very fine concasse out of it. So if you know how to do a simple, plain tomato basil sauce, I think you've got it right. Anyway, all Italian food in general is very easy. They don't take too much time. The time consumptions, they don't believe in long cooking. So it's all really about alla minute cooking, quick, fresh, where you can still taste the ingredients.
Just one last thing. Can you tell us about the Italian restaurant that you launched in Bombay last week, you said?
Very similar to, in some ways, to Speak Up. That's at the Good Earth store in Raghuvanshi Mills. And hopefully, as I said, it's still, we are just testing the waters right now. But hopefully that will be our first step in the Bombay food market.